कैन स्टार्ट सर, यू कैन स्टार्ट।
ओके, वेलकम वन एंड ऑल फॉर द वेबिनार फ्रॉम अमिटी स्कूल ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी, अमिटी यूनिवर्सिटी हरियाणा। एज यू आर अवेयर, अमिटी यूनिवर्सिटी हरियाणा इज नोन एज रिसर्च एंड इनोवेशन ड्रिवन यूनिवर्सिटी। द बर्थडे ऑफ ऑनरेबल चांसलर डॉक्टर आसिम चौहान ऑन 28 सितंबर 2020 दिस ईयर इज सेलिब्रेटेड एज इन द कैंपस एज इनोवेशन डे। Every year, 1 week prior to the celebration of Innovation Day, many activities of research and innovation will be conducted and were on display. This year also, amidst the pandemic COVID-19, AUH is organizing webinars from renowned resource persons and carrying out the research and innovation activities. The present webinar is one of the series being conducted by Amity School of Engineering and Technology. We thank the Honorable Chancellor, Vice Chancellor and Pro Vice Chancellor for their motivation, support and guidance for carrying out these activities. I wholeheartedly welcome today's speaker, Professor Ramchandra sir from IISc Bangalore for this event. Thank you sir. Saha ma'am, for you.
Very warm welcome to Dr. T.V. Ramchandra. He is an eminent scientist associated with the Energy and Wetlands Research Group at IISc Bangalore. His research interests are very broad and varied, right from energy planning to ecological development, specialization in the GIS and remote sensing area. So a very warm welcome to you. Thank you for sharing your time. So today, the topic of the talk is on ecology integrated sustainable development approaches. So over to you for
actually start delivery of your session, please.
Dr. Ramchandra, hello.
Well, it's not audible to me, and there's a lot of noise.
Can you hear us, sir? Actually, we just welcomed you. You can start your session now, please.
Sir, there is a lot of noise. I am getting echo also. Am I audible to everyone?
Sir, you are audible. Please go ahead.
Okay. So, good morning to everyone. Thank you for inviting me to share my knowledge with the youngsters in your university. So today I am taking you all to the Western Ghats, and also I would talk about how the development has to be and also why the conservation is required. Is the development is at the cost of conservation? Let us try to understand. First, I will start from the basic understanding of the ecosystem. When we look at the ecosystem, you know, we all have studied this in a school. It has a food chain, the producer, then that is eaten by the next level. And now, as an engineer, let us look at this food chain carefully. When you look at this food chain, you will understand the laws of thermodynamics. You know, the material and energy transfer happens when the food is eaten by the next level. So, and you see, that's how the food is synthesized. And also, there is a law of entropy because there is a loss of energy when the food is synthesized at the next level. And whatever is left in the system is converted into the elemental form by this bacteria and fungi. That's why we call them as an environmental engineer. That means when you look at this slide carefully, there's nothing called waste in the nature. The waste is there where waste people are there. People are the ones who use too much of the material which are not assimilated by the nature. When I say the material which are not assimilated by the nature, these are the plastics or a polythene. These are all some of the examples of the waste people abusing the mother nature. Now, let me take you to my study area. My study area is the Western Ghats, from Kerala to Gujarat. And if you look at the latitude, it is from 8 to 22 degree latitude. And when you look at the total area of the Western Ghats, it constitutes only 5% of the India's geographical area. But if you look at the water sustainability, because of the rivers in this Western Ghats, it ensures the water sustainability in the peninsular India. Because of water sustainability, we have the food security. in the peninsular India. And the, there is a linkage between the water to the kind of vegetation that is there in the ecosystem. I'm going to demonstrate that. Now, let us look at the Western Ghats in more detail. Let us see how many species are there in the Western Ghats. You see, as you move from the zero latitude to 60 degree latitude, you see at 8 to 14 degree, you see the highest number of species. Highest number of species means you have a diverse plants and animals. Diverse plants and animals means you have diverse food and diverse medicine. That means 8 to 14 degree latitude correspond to Kerala and Karnataka part of Western Ghats, which has the highest number of species if you look at any other latitudinal gradient. So that's where the onus is on us to conserve the Western Ghats so that we can give the food, we can give the medicine in addition to the water. Now, let us look at the nature carefully. Nature is always in balance with the right proportion of the producer, consumers, etc. As long as two-legged animal doesn't get into the nature, into the picture. Now, when you look at the nature, you also get the let us try to understand the principles of nature. As I said earlier, energy and material transition and optimization, the law of thermodynamics is happening every day in the nature. Then there is a remediation potential. You know, you all would have seen people washing cloth in a river basin. You collect the water sample there. 500 meter downstream, you collect another water sample. You analyze the water sample. You will see that at the second point, there are no pollutants. Where at the point where people are washing the cloth, you will see the chemical ions, etc. That means by the time water moved from point A to point B, the treatment has happened. This is called remediation. And the treatment is done by the organism like algae, bacteria. These are called biological organisms. That's why we call this as a bioremediation. And this is one of the hottest topics today. Many of the youngsters are working on the bioremediation concept. The third principle of nature is sustainability. Younger plants come, the mature one disappear. So that means the cycling of the material happening in the nature. And because of that, there is a sustainability. We will maintain sustainability in the nature as long as we do not hurt the renewability. But when you think of the developmental path, where it hurts the renewability, then you have a problem. Now, let us try to understand how humans can practice sustainability. Now, if you look at these ladies, they must be in the age group of 55 to 60 years. You know, they work in a coastal villages. They collect, they go under the water, spend a few minutes, 4 to 5 minutes to collect a bucket full of bivalves. When they collect a bucket full of bivalves, these are the marine organism which has a shell. The shell is used for the toothpaste or the tooth powder industry, while the organism is the meat is used as a meat. This has a market value of about, you know, the bucket full of bivalves will cost about 300 rupees. That means these ladies earn 300 rupees a day, which is sufficient for them to run their family. But if you look at the people who are in the cities like Delhi, Bangalore, Mumbai, etc., our status is not dependent on how much we earn. Our status is dependent on how our neighbors feel about us. For example, if you have a Maruti 800, your family would be happy as long as your neighbor don't have Maruti 800. The day your neighbor buys a Innova, you see that how the fellow who has purchased Innova, his family become happier, whereas your family starts feeling the pinch of it. So this is a mere the reflection of the way the people perceive the nature or the way the nature is being abused. When you see from Maruti 800 to the Innova, I would say there's only the exhibition of the misuse of the resources. This also shows the arrogant behavior of the human. Now, when we talk about nature, we need to the extract the resources. We should not cross the threshold. Okay. Now, when you talk about development, let us think of development. Deprive the local people of their right to live. For example, in this region, the local people, they get fish, they get the sand, salt, etc. Now, the development in the form of a rail connectivity is provided between Kerala to the Mumbai. But this rail connectivity didn't deprive the local people their right to do the fishing, to cultivate, etc. This is what the sustainable development. So the sustainable developmental path will ensure that local people are not deprived of the right to live, their right to life. Okay. Now, when we do not respect Mother Nature, what happens? Let us try to understand. See, people went on, they You know, for example, there's a famous the example of East Island. People went on expanding the East Island, thinking that land is available. There are no other constraints. But one day, the East Island people have to vacate the island because there was no water. Though they expanded the island, because of the absence of natural resources, people have to vacate the island. Similar case happened in India. During Krishna Devaraya kingdom, the last leg of the Vijayanagara kingdom failed because of the water crisis. That means the cities and the region which faced the water crisis, if you think of development wherein you hurt the water sustenance, then naturally that region will die. So now you all know about global warming, warming of the earth, which happens because of the greenhouse gas emission. Which, what are these greenhouse gases? These are the emissions in the carbon, nitrogen, and the sulfur, the species into the environment. When you burn a fuel, the emission happens. They form the thick layer in the atmosphere. Because of that, warming of the earth happens. When the warming of the earth happens, there are changes in climate. Now, recently we had a flood throughout the country, and drought also, floods and drought follow each other. So which clearly shows the changes in climate is happening. And of course, we have done the detailed analysis in Western Ghats about that. Okay. And there is a water scarcity, and there are conflicts because of that. That means when we pollute the environment, when we have the higher emission changing the environment, which will hurt us only in the form of the flood, drought, etc. Now, how to minimize the water use? Let us try to understand. These are a couple of the slides which talk, give some messages. After that, I will get into the theme of the today's talk. Okay. Now, one other thing is, many youngsters are there. I would say that you all have to eat pulses. Now, when you eat pulses, what are the advantages? Let us try to understand. First and foremost thing is the water use requirement for growing the pulses is very less. So now, what are the beneficial aspects to the human? You know, it helps in weight management. Those who are obese, if they switch out to pulses instead of carbohydrate like rice, the wheat, etc., then they can minimize the accumulate in their body. This is also comes from our experiment. Then it helps in optimal brain functioning. If you want to be more successful in your life, I would say your brain has to function. If your brain has to function, your food habit, you should have dal in your daily food. Okay, is a source of vitamins and also helps in digestion. It reduces the risk of cancer and also prevent diabetes and blood pressure. See, one of my colleagues, when he was the director of the place, he had all the problems related to that position, like blood pressure, sugar, etc. But after retirement, he changed his food habit. He's today 74. What did he do with the food habit? See, instead of having the rice or wheat in the night, he started have his dinner plate today contains 5 varieties of vegetable, 5 varieties of fruit, and a bowl of pulses. You know, when you look at his plate, 5 varieties of vegetable and 5 varieties of fruit, it gives the diversity. When your food plate is diverse, and when you have a stable thing in the form of pulses, a bowl of pulse, it gives a stability to the body. Today, this gentleman is about 75. He neither have blood pressure nor a sugar. So that means having food, right food, also gives you stability in your body. Now, what are the advantages of having the right food? Let us see. Say, for example, to grow pulses, you need only 200 liters of water. Similarly, to grow millet, you need about 200 to 300 liters of water. While to grow rice or wheat, you need 3,000 to 5,000 liters of water. And for a kg of beef, you require 15,000 liters of water. And when you grow pulses, you see the animals do not eat the pulses. It also reduces the human-animal conflict. That means there are many ecological benefits when we switch over to the right food, instead of having a junk food like the pizza or the wheat-based product, etc. Now, when you look at the ecological footprint across the country, you see the developed country constitute 20% of the total, but they use 80% of the resources. Similarly, within the country, if you look at in a city like in the Bangalore, you see 20% of the elite use 80% of the resources. For example, their per capita water consumption is as high as 400 to 500 liters per person per day. Whereas there are other people who do not even get 30 liters or 40 liters per day per person. So this is the imbalance that is introduced because of the misuse of the natural resources. That is where prudent use of natural resources has to happen in our system. Now, today my talk consists of, I will talk about what is sustainable development and how to assess the sustainability of the resources, and then take you to the cluster-based development. That is the reason I need about the another 40 or 45 minutes to give this presentation. Now let us understand what are ecosystem. You know, when you look at any ecosystem, you see that you will see the plants, you will see the water, etc. Now let me share this slide, which is during my lifetime. See, when I was a student, when I was visiting the place, I used to see a lot of water and also greenery were there. Today in the same location, I don't see the water, which could be because of the absence of the vegetation. Let us try to understand this further. Now, this is a good example of a good ecosystem with a lot of water there. See, you know that you are closer to Rajasthan, how much people struggle for the water. Even Haryana is no different. Okay, now if you want to manage this kind of ecosystem, you need to have an ecosystem approach. That means you need to maintain the physical and chemical integrity of the ecosystem, then only you can maintain the biological integrity. That means a particular plants or animal in that particular region depends on the location specific physical and chemical integrity. If you alter that, then you will lose those species. This understanding of that and managing the system is called an ecosystem approach. Now, my understanding is the biodiversity hydrology is linked to the land cover dynamics. Now, let us try to understand what is land cover. When you fly, you see a part of the landscape is covered with forest, agriculture, horticulture. Depending on how the land is being used for forest, agriculture, horticulture, there are ecosystem functions. You all have studied hydrological cycle, nutrient cycle, biogeochemical cycle during your soil. All these are linked to how the land is covered. If the land is covered with forest greenery, you have some kind of the ecosystem goods and services. We can assess that using the remote sensing data. That's what we have done. Okay. Now, let me take you to a river basin. We have done the study for the last 2 decades in this region. This is one of the river basins in that region. It originates at Ambudetta, traverses 128 kilometers, joins the ocean. Now, in this river basin, we constructed a dam in 1965. Now, if you want to assess, because of the dam, whether changes have happened in the region, let us take the rainfall data. Today, you have the rainfall data for last 118 years or 119 years. You divide this rainfall data into two time periods, 1901 to 1965 and 1965 to today. 1965, because we constructed the dam or commissioned dam in 1965. Now, when you do this analysis, rainfall, the temporal analysis, you will see that entire region was receiving the rainfall of 3000 to 4500 during 1901 to 1965. And it receives the orographic precipitation and the terrain is similar. Now, during 1965 to today, when you look at the rainfall, this portion continued to receive 3000 to 4500, while this portion has started receiving 1500 to 1900 millimeters. Now, let us try to understand why this happens. Now, when you look at the topography, you see the stream density is poor, stream density is higher. And when you look at the land cover, using remote sensing data, you can assess the land cover, which means where forest is there, where agriculture is there, where horticulture, you can get that those details by analyzing the remote sensing data, which are the pictures of the earth taken from the satellite platform. And these are available from 1973 to every 21 or 30 days interval, which is what we have used to understand how the land cover is changing. Now, when you see this region, which corresponds to this region, you see on this portion, the greenery is there, forest is there. This is more of agriculture and the barren area is there. Wherever agriculture and barren area is there, you see the rainfall has come down, while this portion has the greenery. If you look at the 1960s forest cover, the entire region had a greenery. Now the changes in land use, converting forest into agriculture or converting it to barren area has led to the rainfall decline. Now to understand this, let us delineate the subbasins. You see the first order stream, two first order stream joined from the second order, then from the tributary. Let us delineate the subbasins. These are the subbasins on the eastern side. These are the subbasins on the eastern side. Let us also understand the topography of the region. Now, when you look at the topography, the entire region is undulating terrain. This gives the forest cover is denser here, whereas here more of agriculture and plantation is there on the eastern side. And this is a glimpse on the western side, while on the eastern side, you have more of this open area, barren area, etc. Now, when we did the field investigation, this is the location where we visited, we collected the plants and animals details, and then we analyzed the rainfall detail from 1901 to 1965 and 1966 to 2005. You see there is a decline in the rainfall of 5% to 10%. Okay, that means there are changes in the rainfall pattern. That is what we even spatially you can analyze. This gives the land use detail. Okay. Now on the western side, you see in the east subbasin, forest cover is 30%, rainfall is 1776. Forest cover is 41%, rainfall is 1715. While on the western side, forest cover is 65%, rainfall is 4,800, or 60%, 4,400. That means there is a linkage between the forest cover to the kind of rainfall. These are monsoon rainfall, orographic precipitation in this region. Okay. Now, we have chosen one stream in each of the sub-basin. Okay. And in each of the sub-basin, one stream we have chosen. We monitored it for 36 months. That is means we wanted to understand seasonal variability as well as year-to-year variability. When we monitored for whether the stream receives adequate water throughout the year, depending on that, we graded the stream as A, B, C, D. Here, the stream which carries the water only carries the water for 12 months. While B carries the water for 8 months, C are the one carries the water for 6 months, D are the streams carry the water for the 4 months. Now let us try to understand where this A, B, C, D kind of streams occur. A type of stream occurs when the catchment is covered with a forest of native species. This is Jalanayan Pradesh or watershed. When the watershed of that particular stream has the forest of native species, you have the water all 12 months. When you convert the forest into monoculture plantation of rubber, acacia, or eucalyptus, it becomes either B or C. When we degrade the landscape, it becomes the D. That means only during the monsoon, you have the water in the stream. Now, let us try to understand the principle in much more detail. See, now here gives a cross-section of the landscape. You see that there are plants. This is a topsoil. This is a wadu zone. And below, this is a groundwater zone. When the landscape is covered with the vegetation of native species, because native species plants are diverse, you have diverse microorganisms in the soil. Because of the diverse microorganism, the soil is porous or permeable. When soil is porous or permeable, when it rains, it allows the water to percolate. It fills this zone, which is called groundwater zone, and then fills the wadu zone. We have deployed the sensors at various levels to monitor how much water gets in and when it gets in. And after saturation of these two zones, you see the water flowing in the stream. That means during monsoon, you have the water because of the monsoon rain. Then after monsoon, the water that is stored in this region, that is the wadu zone, flows into the river or stream for the next 4 months. During summer, the water that is stored in this zone, which gets into the river or stream for the next 4 months. That means 4 months because of the 4 months because of water stored here. 4 months because of the water stored in this region, you have the water for throughout the year. When you remove this vegetation, convert into monoculture plantation, the water might percolate only this much. You know, that's where you have 4 plus 4 months water. If you remove this and make it a concrete area or degraded landscape, water will not get in. All the water which falls here in the form of rain rushes towards the ocean. That's how, since there is no deposit of water in the underlying layer, you have the water scarcity or water poverty immediately after the rain. After the monsoon recedes, you will not have water in the river or stream. This is what is happening throughout the country, including Rajasthan, Haryana, the Uttar Pradesh, where people have degraded the landscape. The water percolation is not happening. That's where we are paying the price in the form of water scarcity. Okay. Now, this dam was constructed for the electricity generation. Now, the life of the dam is assessed based on the sediment that get deposited in the dam. Okay. Now, as per the earlier calculation, the dam life was 100 years. Now, because of removal of vegetation in this region, siltation has increased. Because of the higher silt, you will see that the sedimentation rate has increased. Now, our calculation shows the life of the dam is 75 years. That means we lost not only the water, we lost the electricity also. Now, let us look at the diversity of animals in this region. These dots indicate various the animals like sloth, bear, tiger, etc. Animals are there where water is all 12 months. Where water is not there, only the humans are there. This is what the linkage of between the biodiversity, ecology, and hydrology is. So you understood how the ecosystem, how the vegetation cover in the catchment plays a decisive role in sustaining the water. Now we described the two new species of fish. Now these two species of fish are important from a medicinal point of view, which is used for now. For the fish to survive, the water has to be there all 12 months. Now, water has to be there for 12 months. You need to have the stream catchment having the native species of vegetation. That means this fish has a medicinal property because of the surrounding catchment vegetation, which are native species and which are a diverse vegetation. That's why it has a medicinal property. That means it brings the linkage between the aquatic biodiversity with the terrestrial biodiversity. And these are the new species of algae which we have described. Now my students are working on biofuel prospects of this. Okay. Now let's look at how the animal get adapted to changes in the system. You all know that the frog is known as amphibian because it has stages. The first stage, the juvenile stage, it requires the water, while the next stage, the adult stage, it requires the land. Because of the dual stages in life cycle, the frogs are known as amphibian or dual life cycle organism. Now, if the water is not there, what happened to the organism? Let us try to understand. We came across the particular species of frog, Philatus leucorrhina. We saw that particular species of frog, after fertilization of the young, emerging out, the younger ones are emerging out without tadpole stage. Now, why did they bypass the tadpole stage? Because there was a water scarcity in the stream. There was no water for the tadpole to survive. But animals have learned how to get adapted to the newer situation with the water scarcity. We got those fertilized eggs to the Bangalore. In the lab, I monitored, my students monitored the thing. And we saw the young ones emerging out. That means the organisms have learned how to get adapted to a changes in the climate. I will write it and give you all the things. See, with the global warming, the changes in climate is certain. With changes in climate, we will not have water. When we don't have water, all these organisms will survive except human beings. Whatever our power with computer and all the knowledge, we will not survive. That is what we need to understand. Now, you understood from this part of my talk, the microclimate, the changes. Okay, then water availability in stream through the perennial and seasonality you understood. Then silt tilt, how it reduced the life of the dam and also linkage with the biodiversity you understood. That's where you should respect the mother nature and you need to manage the mother nature. So for managing the mother nature, you need to understand the ecosystem approach. When you do that, you can manage the physical and chemical integrity of the system. Okay, this is the publication we published. This is available online. Those who are interested can go to that publication. Okay. Now, let me take you how the land use changes happens in the region. You know, I told you all that remote sensing data is available from 1973 onwards. The day when we launched the satellite, we have the data. Now, 1973 onwards, every 21 or 30 days interval, you get the picture of the Earth. It is not just Bangalore. It is entire India. It is entire globe. Now, that remote sensing data, you can analyze it. This is what the engineers do. There are various algorithms are available to analyze the data. Now, this is a district we have worked in detail, which has a 3 agroclimatic zone. This is a stream network. See, these are all analyzed using GIS, Geographic Information System. That is another emerging area so that you can visualize what is happening at the local level. Now, when you look at the region, you see the 4 rivers are there. We have analyzed the 4 catchments, okay? Now, see, how did we analyze the vegetation and the animals? Let us try to understand. From the remote sensing data, you can find out where the what are the types of vegetation is there, evergreen forest, deciduous forest, like that. Okay. Now, you do not know what species are there. To understand this in an area of 10,000 square kilometers, it is difficult for anyone to do the sampling. What we have done is we divided district into 5 minutes by 5 minutes grid or 9 kilometer by 9 kilometer grid, and we chose the representative grid. These are our representing coast. This is a hilly terrain. This is a plain. We have chosen the representative grid, and in the grid we laid the transect. We did a mapping of trees in 20 meter by 20 meter quadrant. Then 5 meter by 5 meter quadrant we did the mapping of shrub, and then the 4 quadrant for the hubs of the grasses, etc. Then if we encounter any animal in this region, we have listed that, and also we did the hydrological investigation. Then we left another 20 meter here. And then another quadrant is way late. And we did a similar exercise as long as we didn't get the new species. That's how we did the accounting of the plants and animals in the region. Okay. Now the vegetation, the land use is analyzed using remote sensing data. Now we did the land use analysis. For that, what we did, when you look at the remote sensing data, when you generate a false color composite, you will see heterogeneity. Now you collect the polygon, you digitize the polygon, load it to GPS, because this image is georeferenced. When you load it to GPS, with the GPS, when you go to that particular location, you will you can find out what the attribute is, whether it's agriculture or a forest, etc. Because the when you go here, the GPS will beep. You just note down whether it's a forest or agriculture. Like this, you collect the data for the entire study region. These are all the training data which is used for remote sensing data classification, and you get accuracy as high as 90% when you have the training database classification. Okay, this is the protocol that is used. These are the various remote sensing data of various time period we have used. I'll not get into the details of that. All this we have published. You can download and you can read those articles. So if there are any queries, you can write to me. Now, how the things have changed from 1973 to today, we have analyzed. See, these are the various vegetation type. We have laid the transect. You can see my team doing the measurement, including myself being in the field. And this gives the land use at the various time period, 1973 to 2018. Now, see, look at the 1973, the forest cover in this region is 67% evergreen forest. Today it's 29%. You all should know this district had a distinction of having the highest forest cover in the country to the order of 80%. Today, you see the degradation is happening. Now, using remote sensing data, you can visualize where the changes have happened. So now, let us try to understand that. See, from the remote sensing data analysis of 1973, you see that forest is there everywhere. 1979, this pink color is the 1979, you see where all forests have started degrading. Then 89, 99, 2010, 2013, 2016. Now, when you look at this from 1973 to 2016, you know where the degradations happened, and also you can assess why it has happened. Here, we constructed a dam. With that, we lost the forest. Here, we converted forest into teak plantation. Because of that, we lost here. Because of the human habitation, we lost the forest. Now we know the where the forest has changed and how it has changed. This is useful for energy assessment also. Now we also looked at the forest fragmentation. That I will not get into the details of that. Now let us look at the energy aspect, because I know that I am addressing the students in the energy department. Let me also share how one can use the remote sensing data to do the energy assessment. See, if you want to assess the any renewable energy, solar, wind, or bioenergy, you need to, these are all location-specific, the details are required. So now let us go to the same district. Now what kind of data is available? See, now if you look at, there are the solar energy data, radiation data is available at NREL at NASA. Apart from the you know, the surface, the monitor data is available at IMD, Indian Meteorological Department. Today, the many the institutions are also installing the pyranometer to have the solar energy, the radiation assessment. Now, when you use the NRSAR and NREL data and compare with the field data, you see that it's almost tallies with the field data. So now the surface data is the red color, and you see the NASA and NREL data. That means NASA and NREL data is available for the last 40 years. You can analyze the solar energy trend, and the month-to-month variation you can assess. Now, from this, you see that only the July month, there is a the lesser thing. That means other period, you get enough solar energy. Okay. Now, month-wise, for the taluk-wise, you have the solar energy potential. Based on that, you can see where which region has higher potential. Now, village-wise also, you can analyze. Overlay the village boundaries, you know that village level, the solar potential. Okay. Now, to harvest the solar energy, what are the technology? One is rooftop harvesting. We also mapped what are the rooftops that are available, how much is the rooftop, because people are saying there is no land available. So then we said that no, rooftops are available. When we did the mapping, the rooftops are in the range of 1,200 to 2,000 square feet. In this region, people were required the electricity to an order of 100 to 150 units per month. That means to generate 100 to 150 units every month, you need a rooftop of 100 to 150 square feet or a 200 square feet. Now you have a rooftop of 1,200 to 2,000 square feet. That means you can also generate electricity, feed it to the grid while using for your house. Okay, these are the technology. Now these have become popular. What I talked about in 90s, today these technologies are there in this district. Okay, now we also map the rooftop, what is available, how much solar energy can be harvested. This is the power of GIS. You can go to the disaggregated level or decentralized level to do the analysis. Now, similarly, we also mapped where all the wasteland is available so that we can have the large scale, the solar energy thing for the irrigation requirement, okay? Then we also analyzed the wind energy to assess the wind potential. You need to know the wind velocity and wind direction. So now, again, the same data is available at NRSA and NASA, and also surface-based measurement is also data available with IMD. when you analyze that, you see the surface-based measurement tallies with the NRSA NASA data. That means you can use the NASA or NOAA data for doing the trend analysis. Then the spatial variability you can assess. The taluk-wise, you will get an idea. So then if you want to do the bioenergy assessment, I talked about remote sensing data, which we give the picture. From that, you can find out the forest, how much resources are available. Then agriculture residue, you can quantify. For livestock, you need to go to the field, find out to the population and the dung yield, etc. With that knowledge, you can do the bioenergy potential. So that means bioenergy is a cumulative of the forest residue, then agriculture, horticulture residue, and livestock. The fuel wood that is available in forest or plantation. Now, when you look at the demand, you require, our study shows 85 to 89% of people still use domestic energy, that is from the bioresources, and 70 to 78% use the traditional stove, which has the efficiency of 3 or 4%. By switching over to the energy efficient stove based on a conduction, convection, radiation principle, you can save the energy to 27 to 42%. This is true in the entire country, in spite of Ujjala program and all. I still see people using the fuel wood stove because that works out cheaper and that's of zero cost energy. Okay. Now we also assess where all the what is the resource available and what is the demand. If the resource to demand ratio is more than one, that means there's a surplus resource in this region because the forest is there, they have abundant resources. Here there are scarcity of resources, the ratio is lower than one. So that this kind of analysis also helps in energy planning at regional level. Okay. And we have taken the ratio of that bioenergy to the demand. You see, if the ratio is greater than one, there is a surplus resource. These are the taluks which have the scarcity of resources. Okay. Now, what are the viable alternatives? One is energy efficient stuff. Second one is biogas. To quantify the biogas, we the population of the animal in the taluk and what is the demand. If the ratio is greater than 66%, that if the biogas can meet 66% of potential, you should go in for the biogas in those respective taluks. Where the ratio is less, you should not have the biogas program. That means this kind of decentralized analysis helps in the prioritizing or your block level the dissemination program. Okay, this is summary of my first part of the talk: solar energy, wind potential, and then the what is the PV and this one, then bioenergy potential, then biogas status, and the what are the livestock residue that is available at each individual this one. Based on that, we also came up with the energy plan. This is popular as a regional integrated energy plan. This is available online, wherein all the resources we try to look at and budget it for a taluk level or a district level. Based on that, this one we have implemented in a couple of districts in Karnataka. Okay. Now let us look at the next part, the water. You know, if you want to assess the water quality of the water body, you need to do the sampling. You know, these are the five rivers in the region. Okay. What we do is we look at the hydrological parameter and also we look at the physicochemical parameter and the biological parameter. And our study shows biological parameters are as good as the physicochemical analysis. I'm going to analyze, demonstrate that. Okay, when we select this one, stream or a water body, you first have the hydrological parameter. You find out the depth, width and velocity of the water. You collect the water sample, do the physicochemical analysis and also biological parameter to understand what kind of species are there. Because depending on the physicochemical integrity only, the biological species thrive there. Okay, these are the five river basins. And now when you take the river basin, these are the sub basins. You choose the samples such a way it represents the sub basin like this. Okay, see each sub basin it represents. And first understand the land use so that you will come to know whether this region is dominated by forest or the agriculture land. So based on that, you can analyze the results. Okay, now these are the kinds of organisms. These are algae. These are when you encounter slippery floor in your bathroom, when you collect the sample analyze, you will see this kind of beautiful architecture under the microscope. This looks like a soapbox, but this is a microorganism. Okay. Now, what do? We collect the stone where these organisms are attached, collect the sample, prepare the slide, we analyze the sample, we find out what species are there. Now, based on that composition, we can say whether the stream is polluted or unpolluted. Now, based on that, we did a detailed study. See, you have a stream network, you have the remote sensing data, this is a land use data, rainfall pattern. We also went to the field to find out whether there are any external input. Based on that, we said that which stream is moderately polluted, which stream is not polluted. So now, we also, because of our field investigation, we know that why it is polluted. See, we said highly polluted. It is because we are from the neighboring township and solid waste dumping. And also here moderately polluted, it is because of the industrial effluent. Okay. Now you understood how the water quality assessment can be done. Energy assessment can be done. You understood from my earlier thing. Now let us try to understand what is the worth of an ecosystem. Now, how do you assess the worth of the ecosystem? Let us try to this one. Okay. Now, see, you find out what are the resources are available in the forest. The quantify that timber, NTFP, etc., and then find out the market price. When you do the summation of that, you know, quantity into market gives us the value of that goods in a particular saldo for various products. For example, if you have various types of timber, you can find out J varies from 1 to N. Okay, there are 7 varieties and there are 11 taluk. Each taluk, you can do the analysis. Now we have done this kind of analysis, detailed analysis. Our analysis shows if the in this district, where the forest cover is about 80%, the per year, you know, every year people get the goods from the forest to a worth of 9,000 to 80 crores per year. If the scenario 2, 11,800, scenario 3, 15,000. Now let us look at scenario 1. We have accounted all the things, timber, NTFC, hydrological, water, etc. Scenario 2, I have included wild fruit, because the wild fruit that is generated in the forest is eaten by the wild animal. We quantified that. Because no one goes and gives feeds of wild animals, okay? Then the scenario 3 is the carbon sequestration or the oxygen production. We quantified that also. That's up to 15,000 crores. Now, this shows what is the worth of the forest in the district. You can find out per hectare value also. Now, let us look at what is the how the government agencies account the forest. See, you all know GDP, gross district domestic product. For a district, you have a gross district domestic product. They say for this district, gross district domestic product is 5,978 crores. Now, when you look at the share from the forest, they say 180 crores. Whereas when we do the study, we are getting 9,000 to 15,000 crores. That means so much undervaluation is happening in the forest. So much the undervaluation is happening in the forest. That is leading to the pilferages in the system. Okay. Now you understood how to do the valuation of the forest. Let us move to the theme of the today, the cluster-based approach. See, when you have a cluster-based thing, see, sustainable development, adopting cluster approaches. You know, recently the Prime Minister talked about go local, be vocal, and the global. So the same thing which we had worked for a couple of years, we published recently. I think the Vannamala has gone through that article. So when she invited me to give a talk on this concept, this is the integration of what I talked so far. Now, what are the objectives of clustering? It helps in the taking advantage of the skills available in the local area. Then sustainable use of local resources, and also sustainable use of local resources, and also it helps in the participatory approach. Okay. So now, when you take a particular taluk, find out what all resources are there. Have an industry that meets the requirement of the local region. Now, for example, in this region, what are the kinds of natural resources available? Suppose if mango is available, or the other fruits are available, having agro-processing industry is more beneficial there. That means the decentralized planning of industries or the developmental activity based on the natural resources give the job to the local people. At the same time, they can, for example, if you have an industry in the region, people can work in the industry during, Monday to Friday. At the weekend, they can do the farm activity. That is the advantage, so that even the farm sector get benefited. That's where we said cluster-based development and approaches should be adopted in the country. Fortunately, the government of India has understood the need for that. That's what Mahatma Gandhi talked about in Surajya. He said the country will develop only when we develop the villagers. If we do not do it, only that you will have a culprit staying in the cities over exploiting the resources. These are the various resources, and the cluster-based development is the various taluks that we have talked about. Okay. Now, I'll come to the concluding part of my talk. I have another 10 or 12 minutes to go. So, if those who are interested in my talk, it's all archived. You can go to my web, this one, in the YouTube, you give the YouTube, TV Ramchandra, you will get my talk, including today's talk, that will be available soon. Okay, then we have a channel where one of my students, Dr. Bharat, has moderating this channel, and wherein all those our webinars, etc., we have placed in that setting. Okay, and you will get my talk. You can, whenever you want, you can, detailed one is available. Those who do not have time, because in India there are many people who do not have much time, so they can go for 15 minutes presentation. Those who have time like me, can take up a 2 hours or 1.5 hour presentation. Okay, now you want to learn more, this opportunity to come to a leading institute in the country. My institute is the number one in the country. This is the web page. You can virtually see this one, my campus with the greenery. When there is a greenery, there will be abundant knowledge and abundant natural resources. Okay, now when you come to my campus, you have the water body, you have the forest, you have the climber which are from the Western Ghats. So now if you want to visit the campus, there's an opportunity for you all. The 28th to 30th December, I'm organizing an event popularly known as Lake Symposium, Lake 2020. This is a 12th event is during the December. You are most welcome to come to the campus and attend this one. So now what are the other success stories? Let me share the success story. See, our this one, apart from research and teaching, we also do interact with the schools and colleges. I have a network of about 40 to 50 education institutions. Then we organize a symposium and workshop regularly, the symposium popularly known as Lake Symposium. The 12th event is scheduled now. This we started way back in 98. If there is a resources, create the lake, plant native sapling and nurture them. Now you might ask, what are the benefits of that? See, this is the water body I have created in the campus in 2008. This has become a recreation spot for our students in the campus. And many students also do the algae and other studies in this lake. Apart from this, the students, even the animals are different. See, this is the otter. You know, this is an animal which normally you found in a wild area. You see in our campus in this lake. Okay. Now, for this otter to be there, there should be enough fish. I don't go and feed the fish every day to this animal, but nature has created it. We did the documentation of diversity of life in that biodiversity. This is the algae. This is zooplankton. This is the, you see the birds, and also you can see the fish in the day. Now, this water body from 2008, you can see 2005, I'm taking measurement. 2008 onwards, how the water body, you can see every year. And also you have the otter, and also we have diversity of snakes in this region. You know, one of my students got me the skin of the snake. The snake shed the skin regularly. When we measured the skin of that snake, we found it the length is 279 centimeters. Then I asked my student to find out what is the maximum length that is reported in the country for this particular species, Naja. Then he did the literature review. Then he came and said that 239 to 240 centimeters. So now you look at the thing. Everywhere this organism is only 240 centimeters, but in my campus it is 279 centimeters. Now you all know my institute is the number one in the country. If you want to come to my campus, you need to do a very good job. You need to be disciplined. You need to be sincere. And also you need to score. Only about 99% plus you will get the opportunity to do the thing. If you are on the top, it is because of our students. If students are doing good job and excelling, not only the students, even the animals in the campus excel. That's why this organism, instead of 240 centimeters elsewhere, it is 279 or 280 centimeters in my campus. Now, this is a technology we have given to the society. What I did is, this is again way back in 2009 when I was in the committee, I integrated consented wetland with the algae pond with the rainwater treatment plant. See, you can treat the wastewater. There are three stages, primary, secondary, tertiary treatment. Primary treatment will remove the large particles. Secondary treatment will remove the chemical ion, while the tertiary treatment removes the nutrient. Now, when you look at your sewage generator at home, it has got N and P nutrient. Nutrient N because we eat protein, P because we wash the cloth with detergent. Now, by the secondary treatment alone, we cannot remove the nutrient. And I integrate a constructive wetland oral pond. Anyway, this biological organism requires the nutrient N and P. They take away the N and P, and that's how they so when the water comes to the lake with the solar energy, now this water is drinkable. You know, the success of this is evident from the groundwater. You see, way back in 2005, when I did the study in the borewell water quality, the surrounding borewells had nitrate. Because, you know, people are letting sewage into the lake. As our sewage moved into the groundwater, it got oxidized to nitrate. Nitrate is a carcinogen. But today, there are 300 plus borewells in this area. None of the borewells have nitrate. That means my technology is giving 300 the borewell users a clean water at decentralized way. Sustainable technology, sustainable option. Okay? Now, see, wherever we meet people, we make them to motivate them to take up some nature activity. This gentleman met me in 2016. So he knew about my work. He just interacted with me on that day. Then immediately he said he has 12 acres of land. He said, what shall I do? Then immediately, very next day, myself, my student who are traveling with me, we just did the topography analysis and rainfall analysis. We gave a report to him saying that where the water body to be created, what should be the size based on the catchment yield. And then we gave a report in the May month. You know, I told him the June it's going to rain. If you create a water body, you will have at least 10 lakh liters of water. See, the moment we gave the thing, he knew the implication of not having water, because the 2014 and 2015 being a drought year, there was no water in the region. 2016, when he met me, when I gave this proposal, he implemented within 10 days. And we saw the success. Success is because of the Young Swamiji, Young Sai, and also the youth behind this. And that's where youth is there, always the success is there. When adults are there, you know, the people are in the age group of 45 to 60, you see a lot of politics happen. So if you want to see the progress in the country, that you need to harness the youth power. That's what we have done. And I see the CEO of that institution is also the responsible. He is also young. These are from Alwas Engineering and Science College. Now, seeing the success of this, then we thought that we need to have something in this college also. So we made him to create a water body in his campus, which stores 25 lakh liters of water. And also he took up a large-scale planting. You see that wherever we take up this, the planting is also done. Because of that, you see that when the Swamiji did this, that we also made him to do the desilting of some of the lakes in the region. The, notionally, he did the two lakes, the rejuvenation by desilting, etc. Because Swamiji did that, I saw the large-scale local people started desilting the lake in their taluk. This year also, there was a water scarcity, but this particular taluk didn't face a water crisis. Because of that, the lake management, you see the sustainable management of lake through the desilting, etc. That's how the spiritual leaders can play a decisive role in our system. See, I'm of the firm opinion, science, society, culture, and spirituality have to go hand in hand if the nation has to develop and if our resources has to be utilized prudently. When we do not do that, then only you see the crisis in the system. The moral values will start eroding. Then you see the abuse of the nature happens. Okay. Now, this is a glimpse of the water body in the campus, but thanks to this gentleman. I visited in 2018, 2017, this was created. 2018, you can see already the plants have started thriving. You see a smile on our face and also the greenery there. Then 2019, when I went there, I saw the abundant water. You all, the youngsters, should understand. See, when this gentleman took up the water body, he was alone. When I visited him recently, he got a partner who takes care of the joint family. That means he got an apt partner. The nature has given the apt partner, unlike the other youth who go on searching for the partner in the Facebook and then file a divorce within a month or so. This young man got the partner, and every regularly when I visit his home, I see the happy life in the family where youngster is taking care of their parents and elders at the home. Okay, now let us see what else I have done. This is a climber in the Western Ghat. I was fascinated by the architecture. I thought I should have it in Bangalore, that too in my campus. I brought the seed to the Bangalore. There are 14 seeds. Out of the 7 seeds, I planted in 7 locations in the various part of the campus. Out of the 7 locations, only one has survived next to the building. You all need to understand, this was planted by me when I was a student. I didn't even know that, I will continue in the campus as a faculty. But this plant knew that I will continue in the campus and that it has survived only next to the building where I've been working for the last 2 decades as a faculty. That means nature also keeps eye on us. And today when you come there, you get a feel of the rainforest. And in front of this building, we created 49 species, 500 saplings planted in a 2-hectare area when I was a student. Okay, today you get a feel of the rainforest. And see the hydrological importance of this forest. Groundwater was 150 feet earlier when the region was dominated by Parthenium. Today, I have water at 5 to 10 feet. If you want water, please make sure that you have greenery of native species in your neighborhood. And temperature is 2 degrees lower. And you will see a variety of organisms that are happily residing in the forest, not coming to your home. Okay? If you want to learn more, this opportunity of the Lake Symposium, you are most welcome to come. And uniqueness of this event is the children's participation. You know, children come, on the 3-day event. One day is for the school children and college students. They do the small experiment like carbon sequestration here. And you see the glimpse of the student doing the experiment. And the water quality catchment mapping by choosing the lake in the neighborhood. See, the children have been trained in the orientation program. And children go and collect the sample. They come to the lab, analyze it. And these are sketches drawn by them. Okay. Similarly, rural area kids, they do the neighborhood mapping. We interact with them. There are orientation from like faculty in your institution. I also do the teaching. I also do the research. At the same time, we also do this during the weekend and holidays. Okay. And this is the kind of the experiment the kids do and demonstrate. Those who have done extremely well come to the RAKE symposium, and one session exclusively for them, which is the most popular event in this symposium. And this is a platform where all stakeholders take active part in the event. Okay. Now, my students are looking at more on the algae. These are the diatoms. You know, you have oil in the algae, which you can convert it into biodiesel or a bioethanol. So the work what I did way back in 2009 on solar, there's a mapping for the entire country. Now today you have a solar program. Now today my students are working on biofuel. I am of the opinion the country has 65% use. If we harvest solar and biofuel, you can meet the energy requirement of transportation sector. The liquid fuel, the solar will give the solar and wind. With the use, you can make the country the by 2025 developed country with a sustainable option. Okay, this is the article available online. You can download that, read that, and these are the publications. You know, you can go to Google Scholar to see what is our profile is. And I also conduct the event popularly. This is the on environmental management. Now the 18th session started in September till December. This is there. This is in addition to my regular teaching in the institute. Okay, this is done 1 week program. They come in September and December again. They will come and they write a final exam. They'll get the degree certificate. This is the 18th event I have conducted now. If you want more details, this is the webpage you can go in for. When you access my group webpage, it looks like this. These are research paper section. You can download the literature. The based on the theme, it is organized. Okay, similarly related to water, etc. Okay, if you have done a good job, I would say the success is because of the young brigade behind me. When they do a good job, they keep a smile on our face. Everyone will be happy. Because we have given the society the sensible youth who manage the system. Today, my students are in various institutions, IITs, etc. So, and those who want more details, these are the portals where you get all our publication. You are most welcome to go through that and take an opportunity to come to IISc as a student. Okay, I wish you all the success. Thank you very much. So, I think I have taken the allotted time of 12:30 now. I'm winding up my session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting, and also it created a lot of interest with us. Can you hear us, sir? I mean, what I'm speaking, can you hear? I think there is an audio problem with sir's side. Sir, can you hear me? I'm talking. Sir, can you hear us, please?
Sir, there is no Ramchandra, when you speak. Any other mic?
I think from your side there must be an echo.
Any questions, I am ready to take up. Okay.
Yeah, that's what, sir. I just wanted to take up a few questions which people have already posted here. Hope you can hear me. I don't think there will be. I think sir has a problem with the audio from his side. There is a lot of echo from his side, I think. Anyway, it was a very good, the talk given by Dr. T.V. Ramchandra. And it is very interesting also. And his last word, which says that, you know, like along with that, they take the youth together, that is really a good one. Is the audio okay, sir, now? Can you hear me, sir, please? Is the audio okay, sir? Not audible. Sir, whatever you spoke, it was very good for us. I mean, it was audible to us, but I think you are not able to hear us from this side.
Okay, there are three questions which I see in the chat section.
Yes, sir.
I will read it out and then answer that. What is the difference between protecting or preserving the environment? When you protect, then only preservation happens. To preserve, you need to have a protocol. You know, then only that protection of the ecosystem will happen. For example, when I talk about a river basin, you need to manage the basin, the catchment area. When you take up the measures, then to ensure the success of conservation, you need to protect that. You need to prevent the external forces. That's what the difference between the protection and the preservation. Protection leads to the preservation of an ecosystem. Okay. Then the second question is from Ranjana Arora. What could be the job of universities to achieve sustainable development goals? I'm a part of the university. Our job is to come up with the technology which are least harmful to the nature. At the same time, meet the requirement of the people and alert the people, you know, bring the awareness among the public, bring the awareness among the youngster, is the responsibilities of the teaching faculty in the institution. You know, we want academicians who are doing a noble job of teaching should also go to the society and bring awareness. When they bring awareness, probably the misuse or abuse of Mother Nature will come down. Okay, there's another question. Again, sir, please put some light on the current government initiative and policies on achieving sustainable development. The current government, irrespective of the color, they know only how to speak. How to practice has become a big problem. I would say that recently, some of the environmental legislation, there is an erosion. You know, the good example is the EIA 2020 draft notification. If that is accepted by the parliament, it is going to create a havoc in the country. You know, for the sustenance of the resources, for our children, the youth of the country, we need to make sure they have a clean air, clean water and environment. That clean air and water environment can only be provided by a good ecosystem. For an ecosystem to be in a good shape, we need to do proper planning and we need to have proper policies in this country. If you dilute the policies, then we are leading to the erosion. That's what is happening in the country today. There are pollutions happening everywhere. For a classic example is Bangalore. Bangalore has become a dead city with higher levels of pollutant in the water, and yet the increase in the respiratory diseases and water contamination is leading to the, you know, heavy metal in the water is also being transferred to the food chain through the agriculture or the vegetable that is grown with the, you see that is evident from the kidney failure in the city. The kidney failure, which was 1 in 1 lakh 10 years back, today is 1 in 5. You see more and more people losing the kidney. That is because of the pollution in the water and the land environment. That is where we need to understand if the industries treat it and let it into the ecosystem, the cost is very less compared to polluting the environment and then come with a remediation measure like Ganga rejuvenation. Earlier government said 10,000 crore, today 20,000 crore. It has become only to spend money than achieving the actual goals of the ecosystem or environment. Okay, that is where when the youth are healthy, they become asset to the nation. For youth to be healthy, we need to provide a good ecosystem and environment. For a good ecosystem and environment, you need to have a proper policies and legislation. The government has to understand youth of the country are asset of the nation. Healthy youth will add to the worth of the nation. Whereas if there are sick population, then you see the entire country losing the resources, the talent, the system. Okay. There is a question, is there any biodiversity model and regulatory model available to stop depletion? That we need to know what is the state of the thing, what we did, the documentation of that. We monitored the ecosystem, then we came up with a policy guideline, and also through our intervention of mini forests and all, we have shown success model. Now people, if they say that there is no link between the forest and trees and the water, my experiment on mini forest demonstrated that. Not only this experiment is in one place in ISC, I have replicated in many parts in the country. Many places people have done this in their education institution, etc. So that is the model. When it is replicated throughout the country, we will have sustenance, water and clean air. That's what the answers require. Okay. Then there's another question. Since ancient times, what have been the major changes in the clustering approaches? I have not looked at the literature, the Asian time. Sadhguru Mahatma's article talked about the clustering approaches. You know, the harvesting the resources and provide the employment. See, when you have a clustering approach, you are optimally using the natural resources. Also, at the same time, you are giving the job to the people in the local level, so that the children need not come to the urban area and create a slum. So, and they can lead a happy life. They will have enough resources. They will have a healthy environment. That's what the clustering approach is. That's what the government need to understand. Okay. Then the next question from Uday Narayan Singh. The 50 lakh trees we had planted on the University of Hyderabad campus when the campus has been established resulted in the great change in the region around. Congratulations. I would say this model has to be replicated in the country. If we do it, we'll have sustainability. When you have sustainability, everyone would be happy. Okay. Then the next question, very interesting and motivating talk. Okay. That's appreciation. Thank you very much. The what is the suggestion on the planting? I would say, when you take up the planting at local level, respect the mother nature through the local species. My advice to you is, when you drape Mother Earth with the local sari, she will retain the water for 12 months and give you water 12 months. When you convert that into synthetic sari with a monoculture plantation, you are making the Mother Earth to retain the water only to 68 months. When you degrade the Mother Earth by removing the trees, she will have water only 4 months. She can give water only 4 months. Then you will have poverty. That is what we need to understand, that from the nature. So I think that I have answered all the questions, Dr. Sridhar. I think your question also I have answered now. Thank you very much. So there is one more question has come, I was told. So as a layman in this field, I would like you to throw light on the impact of social forestry has been on this erosion of environment situation in the last 5 decades after the DNA department of, okay. Now, the social forestry, you know, the fancy thing for the forest department to adopt the exotic species. The species which are not native to our land become alien species. And they require the more resources. That's where eucalyptus plantation in the country, especially in Karnataka, we saw the groundwater degradation, groundwater depletion. So that's where I would say social forestry is a noble scheme. It's a novel scheme. But let us practice it sensibly with the native species. Native species are the species that enhances the local biodiversity, at the same time gives the fuel, fodder, and food to the local people, including all biological organisms. When you are practice of social forestry, if it provides fuel, food, and water to the local people, I would say that is the model to be replicated. In fact, I come to Rajasthan and also to Haryana. The invites me to some of the talks. I have seen how the people have abused the mother nature there. So I would say that if you want water, you need to restore For example, you know, now the crop burning is the issue people are talking about as far as Punjab and Haryana is concerned. They say that the brown cloud is because of the crop burning. But more importantly, you should also, as an academician, you need to understand. Just look at the hilltops in Rajasthan, that Aravalli hill range. People have removed the hilltop. They have degraded the hilltop because of the dust from Rajasthan. It is coming to the Delhi. People accuse the farmers, but let us try to understand the scientific aspect. Scientific aspect is the dust from Rajasthan because of removal of hillocks in the Aravalli thing. The dust is landing in the Delhi, which is creating havoc in Delhi than the farmers burning the resources. You know, farmers burning the resources because there was no other alternative. They were doing it. Now the government of India has come with a large scale bioethanol and methanol program. And as a youngster, if you can come up with the location-specific technologies to convert that bioresources, lignocellulose resources, into the bioethanol or a methanol, I would say you are adding value to the country. The country program, you are all lucky because now the government of India has an innovative program. I mean, that council also, innovative council. So there is a lot of opportunity if you take it up. If you don't take it up, you will make the country to continue like this for another one generation of 30 years. The choice is in your hand. As a youngster, the responsibility on your shoulder. Look at what is required by the country and what technology is required, please intervene immediately and do something for the country. When you do something for the country, you will be happy, your family will be happy. That is the goal of the sustainability. So that's what we need to practice. It. As an academician, our job is to bring awareness among the people and also among the children. When we bring the knowledge to the local people and our students, we are bringing the awareness, environmental awareness. When there is environmental awareness, naturally the abuse of nature comes down. Okay? Then there is another, Dr. Sridhar has written the thing. I think it's more of the, nice to know that he is an alumni of IISc. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. I think because of just this problem, we are unable to talk to you directly. And I thank T.V. Ramchandra, sir. Probably we'll have a series of lectures from you, sir, sometime later. Thanks a lot, sir, for motivating all of us. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, can I thank you. Can I close the session?
Close. Yeah, close, please. Thank you.
Gentleman is in a hurry to close.